Several years ago, my family and I, we were traveling to Branson, and we were going through St. Louis. We were coming in from I-70 on Illinois, going to St. Louis. And if you're familiar with St. Louis, it's a town, there's several interstates kind of converge there, 70, 44, 64, 55. And then there's 270, the bypass, and I think there's a 170 kind of bypass that's kind of in the middle there. But for the most part, this traffic in the city is not too bad, unless there's an accident or construction. In my experience, I've driven all around. I've got a naysayer apparently in the audience today. So in my experience, it hasn't been too bad. But there are a few times where it can be very bad. And one of the prime examples is when like a St. Louis Cardinals game is ending and all the traffic around that happens and people are leaving the city. Well, we were going through the city, and this was before GPS and maps on your phones and everything. So my parents were in their minivan. My sister and I were in my sister's car, and it was a Hyundai Elantra. And if you're familiar with that car, it's about as small of a car as you can get. Very compact. That's going to be important for later in the story, but very compact car. And so we're following my parents, and my dad is navigating. He knows how to get around St. Louis and everything. So he's decided that we're going to go through the city. Now, there was a St. Louis Cardinal game that night, but he thought we were going to get through the city before the game traffic would be a problem. He was incorrect. And so we get close to the city, and all of a sudden we just stop. Unfortunately, there was an off-ramp that was just a few hundred feet back that had we taken that off-ramp, we would be able to bypass all this traffic. And so my parents are stopped in the minivan. My sister and I are right behind them, and we're just going, well, this is a bummer. And we're complaining, you know, kids complain to the parents, I guess. And so we were like, well, what are we going to do? Well, my dad decided, and he was driving the minivan, that sitting in traffic was not an acceptable thing to do. So he decided that, you know what? That grass over there looks pretty stable. You know, there's a little bit of a ditch. It's pretty soft incline. And so he decides to off-road it. And he turns off the interstate and gets up and goes to the off-ramp up there. My sister and I, remember, we're in this very small, compact car. Now, I'm in the backseat. I'm 16 at least, so I could drive. But I'm in the back saying, like, do it, do it, do it, right? So there's no consequence to me if the Elantra gets stuck. It doesn't get stuck. We make it. You know, no injuries happened. No police officers witnessed the scene of the crime or anything of that nature. And we made it around the city, and we got through it. And so regardless of my dad's thought process, if that was a good decision or not, obviously hindsight would say, you know, going through the city at that time was a bad idea. But there's this debate that we have of which way should we go? And I think sometimes we get paralyzed because we can't make the decision of, oh, should we do this or should we do that? But there's also times where we just make a bad decision. All of us. Everyone's done that. And God knows that about us. And yet he knows that. He still wants us. He still loves us. But he also recognizes there are times where we need to get our act together. We need to make sure that he puts us in our place, not in a way that's demeaning, but in a way that says, if you want to get back to me, this is what you've got to do. Because we can complain consistently about God and say, you know, it's God, I'm doing my best here. Sometimes I think that's misplaced. And we find in Isaiah chapter 50, God kind of puts his people in their place. Starting in verse 1, God is talking. He says, was your mother sent away because I divorced her? Did I sell you as slaves to my creditors? No, you were sold because of your sins, and your mother was sent away because of your sins. Why was no one there when I came? Why didn't anyone answer when I called? Is it because I have no power to rescue you? No, that's not the reason. For I can speak to the sea and make it dry up. I can turn rivers into deserts covered with dying fish. I dress the skies in darkness, covering them with clothes of mourning. So God is speaking to Israel, his people, God's people at this point, and they are in exile. You know, when they were in exile, they were there for 70 years. That's a long time. That's a long time to be in exile. And I imagine that people were feeling forgotten. You know, God, where are you? Why aren't you showing up? What's wrong here? And God reminds them, hey, when I came, you didn't show up. When I called, you didn't answer. I tried and you rejected me. They also may have felt they were in exile so long that, you know, maybe God can't save them. You know, when we get to such a place where this is normal, they were in exile, they were defeated by their enemies, God's people were not ruling the promised land, well, maybe God can't do anything about it. Maybe God can't show up. Or maybe they felt so, well, God has just given up on us. You know, we've messed up so many times. We've put ourselves in this position so often and rejected God so frequently. Maybe God says, you know, that's it. I'm done. Maybe God cut them off. That's where they were. That's their mentality. They had taken so many wrong turns that they were in exile and had been there for decades. But God makes sure he puts some things clear in this text. So he makes sure it's clear that God is not the one who has a debt to pay. God has no debt. When God is talking about what happened to his people, to the nation, it wasn't God's problem. See, sin alone separates us from God. Right? If we take sin out of the equation, then we've got full access to God. But when we sin, we put a barrier between us and God. But God is not the problem. In fact, in the original language, God is referred to as Jehovah Adonai, which means he is the owner of the family. That's kind of the connotation of God owns these people. Not in a way that's demeaning or condemning, but in a way that God loves them. He wants them. They are his. The Old Testament has a lot of laws that we would seem to be a little weird for our context. One of them was that a parent could sell their child to cover a debt. That's something that seemed like, all right, that's you don't even talk about it in today's world. That just seems strange. But one of the things about that particular law, that if a parent sold the child because of a debt the parent had incurred, the parent could never, in any circumstance, claim parenthood over that child again. They're giving that child up completely. Even if they were able to get money and buy the child back, they could not do that. So the reason God is talking about this, his people were not sold into slavery because God had a debt. They were sold into slavery because of their debt. So God could still redeem them. He could still claim them as his own. That's the same with us. No matter what debt we incur, no matter how sinful we are, God can still redeem us because God has not incurred the debt. It's our debt that God wants to pay. And God is coming to Israel telling him that is what's happening. But oftentimes, I think there can be a tendency of shame and an unnecessary burden of guilt in our life. Don't get me wrong, we need guilt. There's conviction of the Holy Spirit that we need in our lives. But we become so full of shame that we say, well, maybe God has forgotten me. Maybe God can't save me. Maybe God has cut me off. But I'm telling you what, sin causes shame. But if we focus on God's face, if we just keep our focus on who he is, it's going to remove any disgrace that we have. Not because of our power, not because of our influence, but because of God's grace in our lives. But we have to come back to God's people and the fact that they didn't respond. God came, they didn't show up. God called, they didn't answer. What was happening is that there was spiritual apathy. And that's a very dangerous sin in our world. Because it's real easy to be apathetic, to be indifferent, say, oh, it's no big deal. What's one time? What's one compromise? What's one little thing? And we become immune to the Holy Spirit's conviction. So what should have happened is that God's people should have stepped up, should have been in a service, said, God, we want to follow you. We want to serve you. One of the things I find from this particular passage is the fact of we cannot be passive and follow Jesus. We've got to be active. It's an active relationship. And it's not one of those things you have to bulldoze people. So sometimes the opposite of passive is being aggressive. I'm not talking about being aggressive. I'm talking about being assertive and saying, Jesus, I want you. I want to be close to you. We've got to go. We can't just sit still. We've got to be active in that relationship. God's people had sunk pretty low. For 70 years, they were in exile. So it's not as though they just messed up once. It's not as though they stumbled. They had really put themselves in a bad position. They had put themselves in a bad spot that made it so they didn't know how they could proceed. But I love how God kind of refutes a particular claim. He says, is it because I didn't have the power to save? And he goes in and talks about the laws of nature. If we were asked, we would say, you know, God controls the laws of nature. Right? God is the creator and sustainer of life. We know those types of things. But if we would just take a step back and remember all the powerful things God has done throughout history, and these are the only things we have recorded. God has done many things that we don't even know about. I mean, you think of the different things that he's done. Of one of my favorite ones is that he literally made the sun stand still. He just decided, you know, Joshua prayed and God said, you know, sun's going to stand still. And God did that. He parted the waters. He brought water from the desert. He calms the storm. That's who God is. So when we talk about, is God powerful enough? Well, just look at him. Look at his history. Look at what he's done. If you believe any of what he's done, then my goodness, his power is greater than we can imagine. He is not limited to the laws of nature as we understand them. But the church, God's people, you know, sometimes we tend to live in darkness. We allow sin to creep into our lives and it pulls us away from who God is. So our mission is to take the light of Jesus to the world, right? We talk about, you know, we want to impact the world with the love and message of Jesus Christ. We want to be the light of Jesus in this world that contrasts the darkness of sin, and this light provides freedom and healing and restoration, and this light is great. But the church doesn't always function that way. If we would take a look at ourselves, I think there are times we would be shocked to see how internally focused we are, how organizationally focused we are. That we focus on how can we maintain what we have instead of how can we impact the world with the love and message of Jesus Christ. Because there's a difference with those questions. And there's a difference with what God is calling us. You know, we can function as an organization. That's not the point. See, our mission is not to function as an organization. It's to function as those who impact the world with the love and message of Jesus Christ. And that shifts our understanding. Now, as I'm thinking about the direction we're going, about the route we take, you know, I mentioned St. Louis had all these interstates and had the bypasses around it. And in years past, I think there would be a debate of which is the fastest route. Today, we just put the address in our phone and say, you know, whatever device we have is take me the fastest way, right? So I hardly even debate about it, hardly even think about it. I just go. But one of the things I find is regardless of which one's the fastest route, whether we take the bypass or we go through, they all connect back to each other. Not in a way that's dismissive, you know, one's better than the other at particular times. But one of the things that we can get caught up in is that we can spend so much time trying to figure out what the best route is that we waste time. That we miss the opportunities that Jesus is giving us instead of just going. Because what I believe is that if we humbly seek to serve Jesus, he's going to get us to where we need to be. But even if we're humbly serving him and seeking him with everything we have, we're going to make some wrong turns. But you know what Jesus does is he recalculates. And he says, oh, you messed up here. Oh, keep going. I know how to get you back. You just keep serving me. I know how to get you back. Keep coming. And this is what God is doing here in Isaiah. Because he's rebuking his people in the first three verses and saying, why weren't you there? Why didn't you show up when I came? Why didn't you answer when I called? And then in verse 4, we get a shift. And we enter the scene, what is referred to as the suffering servant in Isaiah. And we're referring to Jesus. This is Jesus who we can understand is speaking in verse 4. And he's saying, the Lord has given me his wisdom so that I know how to comfort the weary. Morning by morning, he awakens me and opens my understanding to his will. The sovereign Lord has spoken to me and I have listened. I have not rebelled or turned away. I offered my back to those who beat me and my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my face from the mockery and spitting. Because the Lord helps me, I will not be disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a stone, determined to do his will, and I know I will not be put to shame. The one who brings justice is near. Who will dare bring charges against me now? Where are my accusers? Let them appear. See, the sovereign Lord is on my side. Who will declare me guilty? All my enemies will be destroyed like old clothes that have been eaten by moths. So we find here is first and foremost that God is the one who sustains the suffering servant. He's the one who sustains the persecution, the beating that the suffering servant endured. Now, one of the things about Jesus that we always have to keep in mind is that he was fully God and fully man. But while he was on earth, while he was doing ministry, Jesus did not use his divinity for his advantage. It's not as though Jesus says, well, I'm going to provide a miracle so life's easier for me. The only time that Jesus used his divinity was for God's glory to be displayed. It wasn't for himself. So we have to make sure we recognize that. Because when I say God sustains Jesus, well, Jesus is God. So how does that work? It's God is actively in Jesus' life, sustaining him and helping him. And Jesus came to help the weary. He came to help the lost. He came to draw us to who God is. But in order to be sustained by Jesus, in order to be helped by Jesus, we have to recognize we need him. We have to recognize that we have made wrong turns, that we are off course, that things aren't as they actually should be, and that we need this suffering servant. But the suffering servant is different than us. Jesus is different. Hebrews tells us that he was tempted in every way, yet he is without sin. So he knows the struggles we have. He knows the temptations we have, and yet he is overcome. And he provides us a way to get back to God, not in a way where he's wagging his finger at us, but in a way that says, I want you. I did this for you. I suffered for you. I endured this pain for you. That's who Jesus is, and that's what he did. He offered his back to those who beat him. He offered his cheeks to those who pulled out his beard. And he didn't hide. He didn't hide from his tormentors. He didn't hide from those who were disrespecting them, who were mocking him, who were trying to hurt him. But it was only through the power of God that Jesus was able to do this. But it required that the suffering servant submitted to God. It's not as though God just said, you know, this is going to happen. The suffering servant had to submit to who God is. And he sets the example for us. The suffering servant didn't care about his personal safety, didn't care about his lifelong dreams, didn't care about his personal ambition or anything else. He just cared about being obedient to the Father, cared about being obedient to who God is. The suffering servant was innocent. He didn't sin. He didn't do anything that would pull him away from who God is. He was falsely accused. He was beaten. It was vindictive, but he believed that God would vindicate him. The suffering servant endured this, not just because he was self-righteous, not because he felt like this was a good idea, but because he believed that this was the best path that God had given humanity. See, God's response to sin is coming in here, and I just think it's mind-blowing that God is rebuking his people in the first three verses, and then the suffering servant comes and says, I got this. I got a way for these people to get back. I've got a way to restore what has been broken. Amen. You know, one of my favorite concepts is in Genesis chapter 3. Because it shows God's response to sin. In fact, we find the first prophecy of who we later find it as Jesus in the response to sin. See, you know, there was hardship. You know, Adam's going to have to work the ground. It's going to be hard. There are going to be birth pains. There are going to be difficulties for women as well. Men and women are going to struggle in this world. But then God says to the woman, I'm going to raise somebody up. I'm going to raise somebody up that's born of a woman. He's talking about Jesus, and the enemy will strike his heel, but Jesus will step on the enemy, and he'll get rid of him for good. That is God's response to sin, not, you guys messed up, here are the consequences. It's, you messed up, here are the consequences, but here's how we're going to fix it. He says, we're going to get back. We're going to come back, and that's where the suffering servant comes in. But the suffering servant had to suffer. It's suffering. It was a difficult time. And in fact, the way that Jesus died was a horrific way, a very painful way, but a very demeaning way. The Romans would crucify criminals on a cross as a way to increase the amount of suffering they endured, but also in a way for everybody else to see the humiliation that they endured as a warning. You don't want to be like this person. You better get your act together. But you know what? Even through all of this, even though Jesus endured this humiliation, he wasn't disgraced. Because he kept his focus on God's face. When he focused on being obedient, focused on serving God and staying true to him and doing what God had called him to do, there was no disgrace that this world could put on him that would stick. Nothing was there. Nothing was legitimate. So people would try to accuse him. People would try to make all these accusations and charge him. But God is vindicating Jesus. Jesus was not disgraced because of any of that. But one of the things I think we need to recognize is when Jesus calls us back to him, when he calls us back to God, there's a transformation that he wants to put into our lives. Because I think for the most part, Christians are at least trying to serve Jesus, you know, trying to do certain things, trying to get closer to him. I think there's good intentions. But there's something greater that Jesus wants to do in us. See, I think when we first come to know Jesus and we say, hey, Jesus, will you forgive me of my sins? He provides a covering for us. And so I think in that moment, he makes us not guilty. But Jesus says, I don't want to stop there. See, there's a difference in a verdict that's not guilty and a verdict that's innocent. And Jesus says, I want to come and I want to transform you and move in your life so that all of the shame, all the guilt, all the sin is just eradicated and taken away. Jesus says, I want to do that for you. He wants to provide a covering, but then he wants to change us. See, followers of Jesus, there's always this tension in our lives. You know, if you've accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, then what happens is you are both righteous and unrighteous at the same time. Because, you know, you're a sinner. You're not perfect. You're going to mess up, so you're unrighteous. But you've got Jesus living inside of you, and if you've got Jesus living inside of you, you're righteous. But Jesus says, don't just stop with the covering. Let's do some real work here. Let's keep moving forward. And we come to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. And it says, we all who with unveiled faces, this is talking about when Moses was coming down the mountain and he had the glory of God on his face and he had the veil to cover. So we're going to unveil our faces. We contemplate the Lord's glory. We are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. We are being transformed. And, you know, I'm not an English major, so some of you may have a greater grasp of this than I do, but we are being transformed is in the present progressive tense, which what it means is it's happening now and continuing to happen in the future. It's not just one of those things where, well, I was saved, and now I'm just skipping through the rest of life doing whatever. It's we are continuing to move on this spiritual journey, getting closer and closer to Jesus. We are being transformed. And so what Jesus is telling us is you may have gotten off on the route, but here's how you get back. And if you keep serving me, you're going to get closer to me and closer to me, and you're going to become more like me and more like me and less like your old self. That's what it means to get back to God. That's what God envisioned for his people. His response to sin was, here's the solution. You guys messed up. You've made mistakes. You've gotten off course, but I want to bring you back. Now, God doesn't tolerate sin. He's not happy when we do it. He's not pleased or excited when we mess up. But if God's not going to condemn us, why are we worried about what the world says? The suffering servant here is saying, you know, where are my accusers? Let them show up. Who can bring a charge against me? Who can actually declare me guilty? The one who vindicates me is near. The one who brings justice is near. God is near, and he wants to remove all this sin, all this shame, all this guilt. But we can't receive this freedom, this grace, this transforming power by being passive. We've got to be active. We've got to move towards Jesus. We can't just sit there. We can't just wait for it to come to us. But I want to challenge you today. Don't get too worried about making the wrong mistake, the wrong step. Because if we just keep our eyes on Jesus, if we keep focused on him, we focus on his face, then we're not going to have any disgrace. We're not going to be lost. We may make mistakes, but he's going to provide a way back for us. And I know there's a balance between intention and action. And so following Jesus is not just about intention, but this morning I want to challenge you to make sure that you just seek him. That you go after him, that you serve him. You may make a wrong turn. You may make a mistake, and other people may recognize it. But if you stay humble and you stay hungry for Jesus, he's going to provide a way back for you. That's God's response to sin. You messed up, but here's the solution.